Hello! In today's lecture, we revisit conduction and diffusion. That is, we are going to study again Fourier and Fick's law. In the basic transport phenomena MOOC, we saw that both heat and mass can be transported via diffusion. Fourier's law reads in one-dimensional form, phi sub q equals minor lambda a dt over dx. And similarly, Fick's law is phi sub m is minus diffusion coefficient times a times dc over dx. We saw that when a strip of material, say a piece of wood, is hot on the left side and cold on the right side, heat is flowing from left to right. We also saw that the temperature profile in the piece of wood is a straight line. We could put this in a simple relation. The heat transfer coefficient h equals lambda over d. Or, if you want, we could give this as a Nusselt number. Nusselt is 1. We also saw that for steady state conduction from the surface of a sphere to infinity, the Nusselt number is 2. And we had a more complicated expression for a cylindrical wall. How did we find these results? Via the microbalance. A microbalance is actually what it says, a balance over a microvolume. It is a tiny part out of the system. Let's make a microbalance for a flat strip of material and see how we can use this to find the linear temperature profile. Are you ready for some math? Let's go! So, we start from scratch and redraw the situation. Now we define an x-axis with x equals 0, the left side of the strip, and x equals d, the right side. We're going to set up a steady state heat balance, and we chose as control volume a thin strip located between x and x plus dx in the material. From the left, heat is flowing in, and from the right, heat is flowing out. However, in general, these two heat flows don't need to be equal. Thus, we label them. The left one by x, as it flows in at position x, and the right one by x plus dx, as it flows out at location x plus dx. The heat balance for the strip between x and x plus dx is 0 equals in minus out, as it is a steady state without production. Or, by putting in the heat flows, 0 equals phi sub q at x minus phi sub q at x plus dx. This equation becomes a microbalance if we let dx become very small. Mathematically, this leads us to the derivative. As a sidestep, recall from your calculus that the derivative of a function f is by definition f prime is the limit of dx to 0 of x of f at x plus dx minus f at x divided by dx. We can write our balance in this form by dividing left and right by dx. We see that the derivative of the heat flow is 0. Thus, the heat flow itself must be a constant. That is no surprise. The heat balance told us that in a steady state, without production, the heat flowing in equals the heat flowing out. Thus, the same heat flow runs everywhere. However, rather than solving this equation, we will take one step back and work with heat balance shown on the sheet. Here we are going to use that heat flows via conduction. And thus, we can plug in Fourier's law. First, let's simplify this as much as possible. We have the left and the right area of the strip, that is A, in both terms. As A is a given constant, we can divide it out. Secondly, we take a material that has a constant lambda, like a piece of wood. Thus, we can divide lambda out as well. So, we are left with the derivative of the temperature at x plus dx minus the derivative of the temperature at x equals 0. This looks complicated, but if we take a closer look, it actually states that the function between the brackets at x plus dx minus that function between brackets at x equals 0. Thus, we have that the gradient on the right side minus that on the left side of the strip is equal to 0. Divide by the x to get the derivative and simplify notation, writing it as the derivative of the bracket terms is 0. This equation looks complicated, but actually it's rather straightforward to solve. First, we realize that if the derivative of a function equals 0, that function is a constant. Our function itself is a derivative, but that doesn't change the argument. Thus, we get dt dx is c1, with c1 some yet unknown constant. But if dt dx is a constant, then t is linearly depending on x. We can find this by multiplying left and right of our equation by the x and get dt equals c1 times dx. Next, we integrate both sides and add an integration constant to the right. Finally, we have indeed that t is a linear function of x. The two integration constants c1 and c2 are found from two boundary conditions. At x equals 0, the temperature of the plate is T1, and at x equals d, it is T2. Substitute these boundary conditions in our T equation, and we find the solution to our heat transfer problem. Tx is T1 plus T2 minus T1 times x over d. So far, so good. What about the sphere and the cylinder? Let's first do the cylindrical shell. Now we have a hollow cylinder with a hot inner wall and a cold outer wall. What will be the temperature profile in this wall? Also linear? No. It is not linear, as we will see. To find the profile, we will, like in the case of the strip, set up a heat balance over a cleverly chosen control volume. In this case, the temperature will decrease with increasing distance from the center of the cylinder. If we take a cross-sectional view, we expect that the temperature decreases with increasing radial distance r. Thus, in analogy with the strip, we take as the control volume a ring in the cylinder wall between r and r plus dr. As the inner wall of the blue ring is hotter than the outer wall, heat will flow into our control volume at the inner dashed line, that is at radius r. Likewise, heat will flow out through the outer dashed ring at r plus dr. Again, we set up a steady state heat balance for the control volume between the dashed rings. It's a steady state without production in the control volume, thus we have 0 is 1 in minus out. Or in mathematical terms, 0 is phi sub q at r minus phi sub q at r plus dr. As the heat transport is via conduction, also here Fourier's law applies. Now we have to write it in cylindrical coordinates. It is phi sub q is minus lambda times a times dt dr. This looks pretty much like we had before, but don't be fooled. There is a catch here. The area A is not the same for the inner dashed ring as for the outer dashed ring. The area A is 2 pi r times L, with L the length of the cylinder, and A is thus a function of r. The heat balance thus becomes more complicated. We can still simplify by taking out lambda, 2 pi, and L. Furthermore, we can bring r in the first term into the brackets, and similarly at r plus dr in the second term in the brackets. For that one, we should no longer write R plus dr, as outside the brackets, the subscripts indicate that everything inside the brackets should be taken at R plus dr. This equation can be shortened further, as it is actually the derivative of the function R times dt dr, just like we have done for the strip, but now with an extra coordinate r. This is a consequence of the cylinder geometry we are dealing with. We can solve our equation by integrating once, giving r dt dr equals c1. We can further solve for t by bringing r from the left side to the right side, as well as dr, giving dt equals c1 over r times dr. If we integrate this, we get t as a function of the radial position. T equals c1 times the natural log of r plus c2. Both integration constants c1 and c2 follow again from the two boundary conditions we have. At r equals r1, t is t1, and at r equals r2, t equals t2. If we substitute these boundary conditions, we find the actual temperature profile in the wall of the cylinder. Now that we have found the temperature distribution, we can also calculate the heat flow through the wall. As we see, it does not depend on the radial position in the wall. We already knew that from the microbalance, and it's good to see it confirmed here. The heat flux, that is, the heat flow per unit area, can be found from this expression by dividing by the area that the heat flows through. The area does depend on the radial coordinate. It is 2 pi RL, and thus the heat flux is inversely proportional to the radius. Finally, now that we have the heat flow, we can also compute H, the heat transfer coefficient. We leave that as a small exercise for you to do. Okay, we have done the strip and the cylindrical shell. What remains is the sphere. By now, we understand what to do. Select the proper volume around the sphere, that is, a spherical shell outside the sphere between R and R plus dr. Next, set up a steady state heat balance for this shell. This will again lead to 0 is in, minus out. Note that this looks pretty much the same as for the cylindrical case. We write the heat flows again using Fourier's law. But there is a difference. The area through which the heat flows in is now the area of a sphere with radius r. It is 4 pi r squared. Putting this all together, we get the equation you see on the sheet. We can simplify this as we did before and solve it. Take a pause here and look at the solution. We have two integration constants, c1 and c2. Thus, we need two boundary conditions. At the surface of the sphere, the temperature is fixed at T1, and really far away from the sphere, the surroundings is at T2. Mathematically, this boundary condition is that as R goes to infinity, the temperature approaches T2. If we substitute these boundary conditions in our general solution, we find the temperature distribution outside the sphere. T is the temperature difference between the surface of the sphere and far away, multiplied by capital R over small r plus T2. From this we can compute the heat flowing using Fourier's law. Phi Q equals 4 pi lambda R times the driving temperature difference. Finally, we compute the heat transfer coefficient H, equaling lambda over capital R. And thus, find for the Nusselt number, as we saw in the previous MOOC, Nusselt is 2. What about diffusion? Well, that is now really simple. All you need to do is repeat the analysis we did and write D, the diffusion coefficient, instead of lambda, and C, the mass concentration, instead of the temperature. Everything else stays the same. In this sheet, you see the concentration distribution for the three cases we considered. It's a very good exercise to redo the entire analysis yourself, but now for mass transfer with Fick's law. Do it and check your answers with the sheet. To wrap up, we have used a microbalance, that is a balance over a very thin slab or shell, to derive the differential equation for the temperature or mass concentration. For steady-state conduction and diffusion, this gives us an equation that we needed to integrate twice. Thus, we found two integration constants and had to use two boundary conditions. With these, we can find the exact temperature and concentration profiles. Once we have these, we could calculate the heat or mass flow rates and thus find the transfer coefficient and Nusselt or Sherwood. That's all for this lecture. Pretty mathematical, wasn't it? Please make the exercises, always starting with a sketch of your problem. Good luck and see you at the next lecture.